Hare Krishna, everyone. Please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada and welcome to yet another episode in this series, Glories of the Asthasakhis, brought to you by the ISKCON Vaishnavi Ministry. Today we have with us Her Grace Sita Mataji, who is another Vaishnavi, another devotee with whom we are going to delve deep into the glories, the pastimes, and the qualities of Sri Ranga Devi Sakhi, who is the seventh of the Varishta Gopis. Sri Ranga Devi Sakhi ki jai. Before I hand over the stage to Sita Mataji, I would love for our audience to know something about Her Grace Sita Mataji so that we have that connection with our guest for today. So Her Grace Sita Mataji is a qualified dentist, and she's also very passionate about working for the environment and youth and women. She is a BDS in dental surgery, and she holds an MS in psychotherapy and counseling. She started Bhakti Vedanta Hospital Youth Foundation, under which she conducted the AIDS awareness counseling program for the youth based on culture and traditional value systems of India, for a decade starting from 2006 to 2016, and this program impacted more than 50,000 youth. Spiritually, she is a sincere practitioner of Bhakti Yoga since the past 28 years. That is so fantabulous, 28 years. Mataji presently heads the Women Empowerment and Skill Development Program for Rural Women at His Holiness Radhanath Swami Maharaj's Govardhan Eco Village, which is outside of Mumbai, in Bada. Right, Mataji? Yes. So this particular program, it assists local women with respect to various aspects such as spirituality, health, poverty alleviation, food security. And it actually teaches them, it nudges them towards making a livelihood through skills such as stitching, painting, handicrafts, food production, etc. As a trained dentist, Mataji gives free treatment and awareness talks in the villages about general health and hygiene. And she also conducts workshops and seminars and counseling psychotherapy seminars, especially for women issues. That is so beautiful. Apart from that, to end particular this particular brief, which is actually quite long, if we start tapping into the, the spiritual, the both the devotional and the material accomplishments of Sita Mataji. But yes, to put a little pause, a full stop to this particular brief, Mataji has participated in many conferences and seminars, such as the Nexus Conference, then the Eco Theology Conference that was organized by the Yale University at Govardhan Eco Village. Thank you so much for being with us here today, Mataji. Thank you so much for sparing time from your hectic schedule. It is our honor to have you here. And without any further ado, I don't want to speak much today. I just want Mataji to start this session. So with that, I would like to hand over the stage to you, Mataji. Over to you.
Hare Krishna, everyone. Thank you, Yashika. Thank you for your kind words of appreciation. And it's my honor to be part of this wonderful initiative of ISKCON Vaishnavi Ministry, which is very, very close to my heart. And it's something which I really believe in, ISKCON Vaishnavi Ministry's goals and mission. And I would love to, help in that, to forward that mission in any way possible. And today, the topic is so amazing, so interesting, that has been selected, discussing about Asthasakhis and their glorious qualities. I mean, I cannot say how apt it is for all of us Vaishnavis to get inspiration from these wonderful, the closest devotees, gopis of Krishna. So thank you for giving me this opportunity. And today we are going to talk about Ranga Devi. And she is the seventh gopi of the Asthasakhis, the closest friends of Radharani and Krishna. And personally, I was just reading last few days, trying to find out, what all we can learn from Ranga Devi and about know more about Ranga Devi. And I found out that Do you know that she was part of a twin? She's the twin sister of Sudevi. Imagine being a twin sister. So it's like two of the Asthasakhis were probably identical twins. But you know very well that even twins have a lot of differences. Though they look alike, probably identical, but you will see that sometimes the personalities are totally different from each other.
Oh,
you know,
many
so
times.
Many times. Isn't it interesting that, you know, she is a twin?
It's very interesting. And Sri Ranga Devi Sakhi is also the elder of the two. So,
yes, Ranga Devi comes first, then comes Sudevi. And they are both twins. That is, you know, it is so amazing. And I would like to tell you that she was born in a, both of them were born in a place called a Sunhera Gram, very close to Barsana. As you know, Barsana is like a lotus petal. You know, Barsana is like the center where Radharani was born. And all around, there are these eight petals where different Ashtasakhis were born. Right? So, Sunhera Gram is the village around Barsana where Ranga Devi and Sudevi both were born. And it's supposed to be like a beautiful place, and it's described in such a nice way that it is such a beautiful place, full of kadamba trees and beautiful. The trees give such cooling shade to all the people who go there, and the flowers, the fragrance of the flowers when they are like, you know, in the rains, when the rains fall, it's so beautiful, the flowers, fragrance of the flowers, that it spreads all around, and the whole, you know, place starts, it's so fragrant. And they create like a canopy, the trees, the all the kadamba trees in this village, they create a canopy. Whenever Sri Radha and Krishna come there to their village to meet them, they can rest under the canopy. Isn't it beautiful? And Ranga Devi is supposed to be so beautiful that her complexion is that of a lotus flower. And just like how all the different sakhis, like Radharani, we know that she's always dressed in blue, right? So similarly, Ranga Devi's dress is red, like a red blossom.
Beautiful.
Cherry blossom. A red dress. She always loves to dress in red. And she is actually older by Radharani just about 7 days. Oh, sorry. She's younger. She's 7 days younger than Radharani. So, and her mother's name is Karuna and her father's name is Rangasagara. And she has a husband too. And her husband's name is Vakrekshana. So these are the few things that is very, very interesting about Ranga Devi and Sudevi, which I didn't know anything about. So I must thank you and Vaishnavi Ministry that just because of this, I had to go and find out so much about Ranga Devi and Sudevi. So this is really interesting.
All glories to you, Mataji. All glories to ISKCON Vaishnavi Ministry, for sure. They are engaging us in this service, which is so beautiful. And you actually touched upon such fascinating qualities of Sri Ranga Devi Sakhi. It was so beautiful. I just wanted to keep on listening to you. It was so melodious. But
I want to tell you some more qualities of her. She has a very, very unique personality. Would you like to know about her nature and the way she, you know, conducts herself and all the talents that she has?
Definitely, Madhuji. I was about to ask you that if we can if we can touch upon some more qualities, because this has started on a very nectarian note by Srila Prabhupada.
Yes. So I want to tell you one thing, that Ranga Devi is like that friend of Radharani who is very, very witty. You know, there is always one somebody who's very witty and likes to make everybody laugh. They have these one-line jokes which they pass and everybody starts giggling. So she's that smart girl in Radharani's friends who is very, very witty, and she loves to make people laugh. So she has a very great sense of humor. But and not only that, you know, she jokes by making all these different gestures by her eyes and her hands. That means she can really, she's so expressive that she can make everybody laugh just by her gestures and her the way she, you know, makes her facial expressions, funny expressions. And not only that, she's very, very diplomatic too. She is diplomatic because sometimes Radharani needs that, you know, somebody very, very logical and diplomatic behind her to give her that, you know, support when she has some difference of opinion with Krishna, or, you know, some, you know, somebody who will give her that. So she particularly is very diplomatic and logical, you know, so that she can come up with these different arguments. So, you know, and she can strategize, and, you know, so she has all these great qualities. And then she is supposed to be very, very expert in rowing a boat. So whenever Radharani and Krishna, they are on a boat, or when Radharani wants to cross over, she's the one who controls the boat. Isn't that interesting? She's the one who rows the boat. So she's very expert in managing the boat. And can you believe it? She has this quality called as utkantitha bhava, which means that she is so much attached to Krishna that she always longs, you know, she's so she's always eagerly waiting to meet Krishna. Oh, when is the next meeting between Radha and Krishna? I'm just looking forward to that. She has that kind of a mood always. And even though she has that mood, but one more nature of hers is very, very prominent, is that she gets angry very fast. She's hot-tempered. That's why, you know, we'll come up with a pastime later on to tell you how hot-tempered she is, you know. But her actual inner quality is that she's very, very attached to Krishna. She's very attached to Krishna. So, just give me a moment. I'm in a lecture.
Okay, that was beautiful to know, Madhaji. And definitely, I didn't know that Sri Ranga Devi Sakhi is so good when it comes to rowing the boat, because we're always saying that, oh, Krishna, we want to cross this ocean, cross the material ocean, the Bhavasagar. And there, Krishna is crossing the rivers with the help of Sri Ranga Devi Sakhi. It is so beautiful that the Lord of the universe, the divine couple of the entire universe, they are always, you know, operating. They're always operating in a way which is favorable to the Ashtasakhis, in accordance with the inner desires, with the love of the Ashtasakhis. So this is how I would like to put it.
Right, right. Thank you. Thank you for sharing that. And it's really interesting how Ranga Devi has such a multifaceted personality. She is like having all these different sides of hers, which is so entertaining. And not only that, I was reading that she has 8 friends, you know. She herself has some 8 assistants, you may call, or, you know, what. But they are also very, very talented friends of hers. Like, I was reading the names of her friends, and Kalakanti, Sashikala, Kamala, Prema Manjari, Madhavi, Madhura. These are like, you know, Ranga Devi's group, you can say. And they are having all these unique qualities, such as they know how to use perfumes and cosmetics. That means they help in decorating Radharani and all the Ashtasakhis before Krishna comes with all these cosmetics. Then they are expert in creating an atmosphere of fragrant incenses. They light incenses and make the whole, area very fragrant and enjoyable for Radha and Krishna. And then when during winters, when it is very, very cold, they carry coal and they light fires, you know, for them. Then they are always fanning the divine couple when it's hot and it's, you know, they're perspiring. So Ranga Devi is also the leader of gopis and who is able to, you know what, control the lions, deer and other wild animals in the forest. Oh my gosh, isn't that amazing? So that they don't come and disturb Radha and Krishna in the forest.
Amazing, amazing. And as you said, she's so multifaceted.
And she has a team which does all these things. Oh my gosh, you know, like they just create all these beautiful scenarios and areas. And like, I think they are like event managers.
Yes, it is so wonderful that Sri Ranga Devi Sakhi, she is someone who is also very witty, who is always joking, and on the other hand, she is also very diplomatic.
And efficient, very efficient.
And very efficient.
With her that team, is, yeah.
Then on the so one hand, she is...
Learn. Yeah, so yes, much ma'am. To learn.
So it is so good. On the one hand, she is preparing cosmetics and those ithra, the scents, for the divine couple. On the other hand, she is also instructing her team, or rather her friends, her friend circle, to actually control the wild animals.
Such a wide range of activities, yes. That's
wide
true.
Range of activities. And I also had few questions pertaining to the services, but we will just address that particular question as we proceed with this particular episode, Mataji. My next question is from this particular aspect, because as you beautifully explained just now that Sri Ranga Devi Sakhi is an expert logician, and she's also known to be an expert in diplomacy, like specifically the fourth activity of diplomacy, that is, she's waiting patiently for the enemy to make the next move. So in this material world where diplomacy, then logistics, logic, these traits are seen to be overwhelmingly masculine. On the other hand, in Golokdham, these traits are possessed by one of the Ashtasakhis. So how can we look at this connection?
Yeah, this is a beautiful observation that you just shared with me. And yes, in the material world, logic, rationality, rational thinking, and then diplomacy, all these are qualities which are attributed to masculine or men, basically. In fact, they pride themselves to that. You know, they think, oh, we are more rational than the women, because women are too emotional, you know. And it's true also. Women are guided by emotions, or for us, emotions are of more of a priority. And sometimes emotions take over more than rationality and logic and diplomacy, right? And that's our feminine nature. So my first thing I would like to tell you is that we should never feel ashamed of our feminine nature, where emotions are is very, very important for us, you know, to express our emotions is very, very important to us. In fact, today, the world also recognizes the importance of emotions. There is something known as emotional intelligence. Today, the world has recognized, and it's known as the emotional quotient, that is EQ. Earlier, people thought IQ, the intelligence quotient, is more than enough.
Yes.
They thought that, oh, you can judge a person how great he is just by finding out how his IQ level is. But today, the world, because the women have shown that because of their soft qualities and their emotional qualities, they actually create such a balance in the world. In so many professions today, people are looking at how people have developed their emotional side, the EQ, because a combination of IQ and EQ together makes a person efficient. Because what is the point of being only diplomatic and rational and, but do not have the heart or the emotional qualities which makes a person really empathetic and caring and nurturing. So I feel that Ranga Devi is a combination of both. She is a combination of feminine qualities, and she uses her so-called masculine side of diplomacy and rational thinking and logical thinking in the service of Radha and Krishna.
Very true.
So I feel what we need to learn is that when we develop our spiritual side as women, when we focus on developing our connection to Krishna through study of the scriptures such as Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, and following the path of the bhakti in a sincere way, what we will see is that we will rise above this material lower feminine qualities of us, which pull us down. And we will be able to develop those spiritual qualities, which is, which can be used in the service of Krishna. That is what is more important. That we become diplomatic or rational and logical, but all those qualities, you should use it in the service of Krishna. Not for our own, manipulative side, just to manipulate people to make, So if we do that, then we are behaving like, a typical woman in the material world who uses all their qualities, the emotions and their diplomacy and their logical side, everything to just exploit or manipulate sometimes. So we need to rise above that and learn from Ranga Devi how she uses all these qualities, but in the service of Krishna. So as devotee women, we should not think that in any ways we are inferior. If we have emotions on one side, we also have the logical and the rational thought on the other side. But both we use it in the service of Krishna. That's our only goal.
That was so beautiful, Mataji. And when you said towards the end that we have both our emotional and also our rational side, and when we use a combination of the two to serve the divine couple, Radha Krishna, to serve Krishna, it is actually the end goal of our lives. I believe that is the perfection of life. And that is something that all of us truly aim for.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for this beautiful answer, Mataji. And dear audience, I'm sure this particular answer taught you a lot. So let's try to learn from Mataji and imbibe the message which she just gave us through this particular answer. Mataji, anything else that you would like to add before we move to the next question?
Yeah, just I wanted to add that so many times women beat themselves up. Vaishnavis, they are made to feel, that they are inferior just because they are emotional. And that, they feel overwhelmed. But I would like to say that never, never feel ashamed for your emotions, because that's our strength, the emotional side. That is also our strength. Because only when we go through those emotions, we can rise on the other side, come out on the other side more strong and more more able to face the difficulties in life in a rational way and in a logical way. That will give us the strength. So this is my experience personally also.
Definitely. I personally resonated with each and every word that you said, Mataji, because feel accepting your emotions, acknowledging them, feeling them to the core, and then expressing them. These are what make you real problem solvers. And they empower you with true rationality at the end of this entire curve. Thank you so much for that beautiful answer once again, Mataji. And with that, we move to our third question, our next question. So, as you described while you were talking about the different qualities and traits of Sri Ranga Devi Sakhi, I would like to ask you, Mataji, that because Ranga Devi Sakhi is multifaceted, she is engaged in so many services which are unique to her. What can be the significance behind each service, each seva that we, the current generation of Vaishnavis, of aspiring Vaishnavis, can imbibe? So if you could shed light on that.
The present generation, you know, the new generation of devotees who are now coming, you know, they have a very, very inquisitive nature. You know, they are really looking for answers. They are looking for logical answers, you know. Like my generation, we were told, you know, we just accepted everything very, very blindly in one sense, you know. Like I was just told, okay, you have to do this, this, and this ritual, and we just accepted it without asking any questions. We never ask questions. But the present generation, they want logical answers. They want to know, you know, in a very detailed way. So I guess that, you know, that studying the scriptures, because that's one more quality of Ranga Devi, because she's obviously logical, and, you know, I guess that that comes from her quality of studying the scriptures. She's like very, very knowledgeable. Because I have seen that, you know, studying Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita is the king of knowledge. Raja Vidya, Raja Guhyam, Pavitram, Idam Uttamam. That knowledge, you know, this king of knowledge has the power to remove all ignorance. So I think the present generation should imbibe this quality of, you know, studying the scriptures in a very, very systematic and logical way, in a very scientific way. And that's what the present generation wants. That's how they are. So by that, when you understand Bhagavad Gita in a very, very systematic, logical way, you will be able to also face the problems in the life today that we are seeing, you know. The problems that we faced in my generation are totally different from what your generation is facing. And your problems are much, much more, you know, you can say more difficult than what we had, because our exposure was less, the distractions were much, much less. But your generation is like bombarded literally, like from all directions. So I guess that, you know, the only way that they can really be focused and stick to the path of bhakti is by studying the scriptures very, very properly, systematically, and always being in the association of devotees. So we also can learn that from Ranga Devi, because she always works in a team. She has a group of friends, and she engages everyone in the service of Krishna. She keeps everyone together and focused in the service of Krishna. So I guess that the younger generation can really imbibe that quality where they learn to come together and use all their talents, express their talents, you know, so that they can serve the mission of Radha and Krishna together. Because that way they will feel so enlivened and they will be easily able to overcome the distractions of the material world. Because they will feel so happy to just be with each other and express their talents and, you know, serve, use it in service. So I feel this is what the present generation can learn from this, you know, from the different qualities and activities of Ranga Devi.
Again, something very beautiful and something which we truly need to apply when it comes to our practical devotional lives. Because many times we miss out on this. And it was so, you were so correct, Mataji, when you said that our generation is literally bombarded with so many distractions. We have many distractions, and one fear which is always there is to actually fall in the wrong association, especially in the material world. So in order to counter that, being in the association of devotees constantly, it is very important. It is something I've realized personally as well. And when you were talking about systematic study, focused systematic study of the Veda, of the Shastras, of the Bhagavad Gita and the Srimad Bhagavatam, can you give some quick tips? Because this again got me very curious.
I mean, studying Bhagavad Gita, studying Bhagavatam, it's like watering the root of the tree. You know, studying scriptures is like watering that little seed of bhakti that we have in our heart. And that should be really given very, very priority, you know, keep it as a priority in our life. Especially when we are very, very young and we have just started out in the path of bhakti. Isn't it? Because only when we hear, only then we will make progress. Because that is the most important, the first step of bhakti is shravanam. So, the practical tip is that first and foremost, understand the importance of hearing and studying. And the next thing is, do it every day. Just like watering the tree, plant. If you forget to plant, water the plant, you know, it will shrivel and dry up. It needs everyday care. So, reading is like that. Reading every day. And yes, these are the two trips, I think, is enough.
Definitely. And these are two very powerful reasons. I think even if we just get these two reasons written down and framed right in front of us, where we can see these lines always, that will be enough to motivate us, to inspire us to pick up the Srimad Bhagavad Gita, the Srimad Bhagavatam, and read. So finally, drawing that conclusion, my personal realization from your answer, staying in the association of devotees, serving in the association of devotees, staying engaged and focused in that service, then reading the scriptures with full focus, without distractions, in a very scientific way, in a very systematic, organized way, that is what we, the current generation, can imbibe from the various services that Sri Ranga Devi Sakhi does. With that, dear audience, you've been very patient with us. Mataji has been so patient with me. Thank you so much, Mataji. We are heading towards the final two questions, after which we will culminate this particular session. So Mataji, my next question is that you were talking that Sri Ranga Devi Sakhi is very hot-tempered, and you're going to cover that in a pastime. So I want to ask you, you know, that one pastime of Sri Ranga Devi Sakhi that has touched your heart deeply, and where can we find such leelas, any references, if that is possible? But mainly at this point, we want to learn, we want to hear, sorry, Shravanam, as you said, we want to hear that nectarian pastime, which has touched your heart deeply.
I want to tell you a very, very personal place which really I love and which I have visited in Vrindavan, in Barsana actually. Of course, Barsana is like the favorite place for everyone, isn't it? Majority of the people, whoever I ask, they say, oh, we love Barsana, because Barsana is, you know, like a place where nectar is just baras raha hai, like the Amrit baras raha hai, isliye it's Barsana, where love just flows, you know. So for me, Barsana is my favorite place. And in Barsana, the most interesting place is Sakri. And that is a place, Sakri core, that's what you call it, is when I walked through it for the first time, it was the most difficult place to walk and cross that place. It was like two kind of hills, you know, meeting at a very sharp point. Like there is only like, only your feet will fit there to cross that. And you have to like take support of both the sides, you know, to balance yourself to cross that Sakri core. It's like a very, very, you know, very narrow place to cross. And that was like the favorite place for Krishna and the Gopas to harass the gopis. Because to go on the other side with the pots in their heads, balancing the pots and crossing that place, you can imagine how difficult it must be. And obviously their speed becomes very slow because they can't run away. Because other times, if Krishna is trying to harass them by breaking their pots, they can at least hide and dodge and run away. But this place, they were in such a position that they could not do anything. And that's the place where the Krishna and the Gopas would wait, you know, because they would become slow and they're all walking in a line with the pots in the hand. And they can't even run. Once you get into that Sakri core, you can't run back. You have to cross on the other side. So they would stand right in the middle and say that you cannot cross. You have to pay us a tax. Said, we have been appointed now by Kamsa to the king to collect tax. And if you want to cross this path, you have to pay the tax. Now, they are in a fix because they are stuck there. They have to move forward. They can't go back. So, that's how they would harass. And Ranga Devi, as you know, is very hot-tempered. So, she saw that this is injustice. How can you collect tax from us? We are doing this, you know, for Kamsa, all collecting all this milk and the chas for, so that we can make the butter. So, how can you collect tax from us? And she would start fighting, you know. She, and there are some very strong gopis and some are very mild gopis, but she's one of the strong gopis, you know. So she would be the one who was arguing, and she and her sister, you know, both, they both would together fight with Krishna. So one day they got so upset because Krishna and the gopas stopped both of them. And they were harassing them. And they made a decision that this is it. Now he has to pay for it, for what he has done to us, for harassing us and breaking our pots. In fact, there is a mark on one of the hills where the pot broke and the chas fell on the stone. It is still there, the mark, if you go there. It's such an interesting place. So Rangadevi and Sudevi decided that we will now instruct Radharani that she should stop meeting him, stop talking to him. So they took that decision, you know, and they said, you just wait what we'll do to you, you know, Krishna, you just wait and watch. So they went and they told Radharani that this is total injustice, that they have made it into a habit of collecting tax and stopping us, breaking our pots, and, you know, really causing such a problem for us. So you have to now, because if you want to be in our team, you have to stop talking to Krishna. Radharani, of course, loved Krishna. Not that Ranga Devi didn't love, but they both loved Krishna, but this is like a pastime, which, you know, this is a leela which keeps happening because it's another side of love is fighting, you know. So this is just to give pleasure to Krishna. They decided now we are going to start fighting and we are not going to talk to him. So even Radharani has to stop talking to him. So Krishna doesn't know what has happened and he thought, okay, you know, they'll forget everything. Every time they come and they forget and they again start talking to me and, you know, loving me and playing with me. So very lovingly, happily, he went to Radharani to meet her. And he knocked on the door and the door straight, they banged the door on his face and they closed it. He said he realized something is wrong, you know. He started calling out to Radharani and he said, your most beloved Madhu, you know, the most nectarian honey, Madhu has come. So she said, I don't know any Madhu. If he's a bumblebee, tell him to go to the flowers and get the honey from there. Why has he come here? We are not going to open the door. He was shocked, you know. So he said, something is really wrong. I'm saying such loving words to my Radharani and she's just ignoring. He said, I'm Ghanashyam, your beloved Ghanashyam who has come. He said, oh, clouds, why are they coming here? They should be raining somewhere. You go somewhere else. So hearing such answers where she was just kind of ignoring him, that affected him so much, you know, because another side of love is, you know, as you said, fighting. Fighting is better, but if you ignore the person, that is very, very painful. So he doesn't mind fighting with them at Sakri Kor. That is something very fun. He gets a lot of happiness by that. But when they close the door on his face and then when Radharani is ignoring him, that he couldn't bear. So he went away in some corner somewhere and he started, you know, really crying. And you know, whenever he remembers, when he's separated from Radharani and the gopis, he becomes very, very sad and he just keeps chanting the name of Radharani. So now Ranga Devi and Sudevi, they had told Radharani to not open the door and not talk to him. But they didn't know that this actually happened, that Radharani did that. You know, that she has cut him off and she's not meeting him. So when they were passing by, they saw Krishna crying. They were, you know, though they are hot-tempered, she's hot-tempered, but somehow her heart melts also very easily, you know, because she is an emotional person and she is very attached to Krishna. So obviously when she saw Krishna crying, she did not, you know, feel happy at all. So Krishna then told her, you know, that Radharani has just rejected me. She has stopped opening the door also and talking to me. She acts as if she's not recognizing me. So Ranga Devi said, you wait here. I will see. I will try to do something. So they went back to Radharani and instead of telling her, you know, they told her that Krishna is very, very eager to meet you and he's crying because he's feeling so much separation. And, you know, they convinced Radharani that by doing this, you have really hurt him so much that he started crying and he's so miserable. And when they described Krishna's, you know, situation to him, to her, even Radharani started crying. She said, this was not my intention. I did all this because you told me. And now, you know, I didn't expect that he'll be in such a miserable state. So immediately her heart melts and they take Radharani herself. They hold her hand and they take her to Krishna and see that both of them meet together and have beautiful pastimes, because that is what gives happiness to Ranga Devi and Sudevi and all the gopis. When they see Radha and Krishna happily playing together and, you know, dancing together, that's what which gives pleasure to Ranga Devi. So this pastime is so beautiful and so sweet.
Very, very sweet and very nectarian pastime. And this actually tells us that how hot-tempered Ranga Devi is, but also how warm and how sweet Sri Ranga Devi Sakhi is innately, internally, and how her heart melted when she saw Krishna crying, that she went and she inquired, and again how diplomatically she played, like she knew how to arrange everything, she knew how to sort it out, because
exactly.
many times what happens is that we create mess. I'm talking about myself, okay, on this very, very material platform. People like me, we create certain things which are absolute mess, and then we just leave it and we walk away. But we see Sri Ranga Devi Sakhi, the way she sorted everything out so beautifully, and the way you narrated this particular Leela Mataji, it was so enchanting, I would say.
Thank you.
It was
Thank
beautiful.
You.
Thank you so much for narrating this particular Leela Mataji, and we learned so much from it. It was so beautiful. I'm sure the audience also enjoyed it, and we got nurtured while listening to you in this particular Leela, and as it is in this session as well. Finally, moving to our last question, Mataji, because we have come to the end of this session, what will be our final prayer under the lotus feet of Sri Ranga Devi Sakhi as we close this session, as we culminate this session? And what is that one last message which you would like to give to our audience?
So we should pray with all our hearts to Ranga Devi Sakhi. Pray at her lotus feet that somehow if she can give us that balance, how we can balance our emotions and our logical, rational and diplomatic side, and how we can use this balance in the service of Krishna, and use this both these qualities of being emotional and being rational in the service of Krishna by preaching the message of Krishna to the world, because that is the mission that we have been given by our Guru and our Guru Parampara. And we pray to her that we develop these qualities by following in her footsteps of studying the scriptures and serving in the association of devotees and using whatever talent that we have in the service of Krishna. So we pray to her for this, so that these qualities manifest in our hearts and in our lives. And like her, we develop attachment for Krishna. An attachment to bringing Radha and Krishna together and seeing, getting happiness just by seeing Radha and Krishna together. So our only happiness should be in giving Krishna consciousness to others. That should be the joy in our life. So today I pray that the present generation of devotees who are joining, they imbibe these qualities of Ranga Devi and help to spread this mission of Srila Prabhupada for many, many more years to come. So this is my message to all the young Vaishnavis who are joining and all the Vaishnavis who are presently in to stay together and be the support system for each other and be there for each other. Because only when Vaishnavis come together can we really bring about a massive change in this world. Because a woman is so powerful that a woman can make or break a family. And what to speak of a Vaishnavi whose only intention is serving Krishna and bringing conditioned souls to the lotus feet of Krishna. Such great Vaishnavis, you know, if they have imbibed all these qualities of Ranga Devi and come together to spread this mission of Srila Prabhupada, imagine the impact that we can create in the world today. So this is the message to all the Vaishnavis. Please be together, come together, unite together, dance together, chant together, read together, practice Krishna consciousness together, and help each other at every step, at every distraction which comes our way. We can overcome that by staying together. Thank you. That is my message.
Such a powerful message, Madhavi. And once again, such a powerful prayer, I would say. A powerful prayer followed by a powerful message. These are words that we would want to come back to again and again. I'm sure this has been one session that our audience would want to come back to again and again. I am definitely going to come back to this session always. And what you spoke today, it is going to be our anchor forever. Specifically, when you said that when Vaishnavis unite, we can actually bring about massive change in the world. So we need to be there for each other. Instead of judging each other, we need to uplift each other, be each other's support system. And that is also what the Vaishnavi ministry facilitates for each one of us. So that is so beautiful, Mataji. On behalf of the ISKCON Vaishnavi Ministry, I would like to thank you, my immense gratitude to you for being our guest of the day for this particular session. We learned so much from you. We were almost lost in the nectarian pastimes, in the glories and the qualities of Sri Ranga Devi Sakhi. And along with you, I just pray that we can imbibe these qualities from Sri Ranga Devi Sakhi as you guided us to do so. And with that, I would like to end this particular session. We come to the end of this particular session. It has been so beautiful listening to you, Mataji. And we can't wait to have you in the upcoming initiatives of the ISKCON Vaishnavi Ministry. Thank you so much, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Yashika. Hare Krishna, everyone. Thank you.
Hare Krishna, and thank you, dear audience, for being here till the end. All glories to you, dear audience. All glories to Her Grace Sita Mataji. All glories to Sri Ranga Devi Sakhi. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Krishna Krishna. Hare Hare. Hare Rama. Hare Rama. Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama.